Thank you very much. Thank you very much, everybody. Good morning. And thank you to be here this afternoon with us. I would like to start my presentation by sharing with you why I think it is very important to monitor a patient at home. Once we decide to put a chronic respiratory failure with non-invasive ventilation at home, we have to consider a balance between the cost and goal. And the costs are not only the cost of ventilators and or consumables, but are also the cost of the health cost, new exacerbation, new hospitalization, new consultation for the patient, the chronic patient. On the other end, we have the goals of need that we would like to reach. So I think the monitor is a sort of needle that is really very important in this balance. What we have to monitor? I would start with a flow chart that the group also NIV published some years ago, and I just make some changes according to our new knowledges in monitoring on non-invasive ventilation. So what is the first level of monitoring non-invasive ventilation depends on what we consider the primary goals, primary aims of non-invasive ventilation. First of all, reduction of daytime PCO2. Clinical improvement, improvement of adherence and comfort, improvement of oxygen saturation, nocturnal oxygen saturation, and in bracket, and I will explain why, a reduction of nocturnal hypoventilation. So let's start with the primary outcome. We know that the first criteria to include a patient to home non-invasive ventilation is chronic hypercapnia. So the main outcome is to reduce diurnal PCO2 and arterial blood gases is one, the first most important way to measure and to monitor this patient. But we have to remember that actually we have no evidences that all the effect of non-invasive ventilation in all the pathologies underlying the chronic respiratory failure, in particular COPD, are mediated by a normalization of diurnal capnia. Another important point is the clinical improvement. I think this is a really important point because we have to know what we have to measure in the next month, next years in a patient ongoing non-invasive ventilation. And in particular, we know that symptoms, apart from mortality and new exacerbation and new hospitalization, symptoms may be really very important. As underlined in this task force in chronic COPD patient, where in the first PICO questions, should NIV, long-term NIV should be used in stable hypercapnic COPD, that means not frequent exacerbator, but stable hypercapnic COPD. Actually, the task force showed that even if non-invasive ventilation was not superior in terms of mortality rate and new hospitalization, however, non-invasive ventilation was able to increase quality of life, decrease dyspnea, to improve exercise tolerance, and surely improve PCO2. And actually, again, for only for this reason and for the economic burden of this important outcome, the recommendation, even with low certainty, were to suggest to make a trial of non-invasive ventilation. So what is important, in my opinion, is to have clear the outcome and to measure this outcome every time I see my patient in the next months. Another important goal is the adherence to the therapy and the comfort. And here, it's really very important, the new technology that now manufacturer offer us. Why the adherence? Some years ago, some studies, above all performed in sleep disturbances and in the restrictive patient, showed that an adherence to non-invasive ventilation higher than 4 or 5 hours per night is correlated to the improvement in PCO2 and to the improvement in the sleep quality and diurnal symptoms. Some years ago, in COPD patient, this study showed that adherent patients had a lower number of hospitalization and a longer time to the first hospitalization. And the same was shown recently in OHS patient with associated severe OSA, where actually the high adherence to the therapy was shown to be correlated to a higher survival, irrespective of the type and the mode of ventilation that was chosen, NIV or CPAP. But the question is the threshold of 4 hours useful and the same for all type of pathologies underlying chronic respiratory failure? And actually, this recent study tried to answer to this question. And if you take a look at the overall group of chronic respiratory failure, actually, they show that, yes, 4 hours is the good threshold to distinguish people who really benefit in terms of survival. But if we consider subgroup of different pathologies, in particular, a COPD cohort, as you can see here, the increasing of the hours of usage during the night increase survival. So perhaps 4 hours is not the same threshold useful to target the aim of a non-invasive ventilation for all pathologies. Another important point, according to the adherence of the therapy, is on the contrary, the increase of usage of non-invasive ventilation during the days, because it was shown to be correlated to, in a COPD patient, to a following exacerbation. And the same in neuromuscular disease, an increase of use of non-invasive ventilation may be correlated to a worsening of the pathology. Now, as I said before, technologies help us in the possibility to monitor this aspect, that is the adherence. And we have different software coming from different manufacturers, but actually they offer us the possibility to have an idea of the time of usage, the daily time of usage, as you can see here. You can also choose what is the threshold that is useful to reach for this kind of patient. And you can also monitor this by telemedicine. So you can have an idea just before or the day of the consultation by using telemonitoring. You can have also the possibility with some software to have an idea of a fragmentation of use during the day. Also, this is very important because your patient may use the ventilator for 8 hours a day, but perhaps above all during the day and not during the night, or there is a big fragmentation, important fragmentation of the use that means also sleep fragmentation. So very important also to take a look at this. So coming to the next step. The next step is nocturnal oxygen saturation. And this is a very important aim to monitor in the home non-invasive ventilation. I can do this by using a saturimeter able to record for more than 8 hours, but now I can do this also by pulse oximeter that are plug and play with ventilator. And in this way, you can, after that, download your ventilator data and have every night recording of pulse oximeter. And in the same way, you can see it by telemonitoring. Actually, what we do before the consultation is to ask to the home care provider to put the pulse oximeter for 2 nights before the consultation, and when the patient come to consultation, we can take a look in for the two, three last night to the pulse oximeter waveform. What is the information coming from these? It's really very useful to detect a problem on ventilation, so really specific, but actually not really informative. For example, in this particular waveform, you know that there is a problem. There are many rapid, frequent oxygen desaturation, but this may be correlated to different mechanisms and different disturbances, for example, central apnea or residual obstructive apnea or leaks. So very specific to detect a problem, but not specific and sensitive in detect the reason why there is a problem. The same is for this pattern of oxygen desaturation, when you can see there is a prolonged desaturation that may be due to a persistent hypoventilation during non-invasive ventilation, or maybe due to a ventilation perfusion mismatch, as is frequent in COPD patients who are ventilated at home, or maybe due to leaks. So if we want to resume, which are the advantages of a pulse oximetry during an AV, we can say that it's really sensitive in detecting a problem. It's very high, it has a very high positive predicting value, not expensive and easy to use, plug and play with ventilator, can be performed at home and possible to monitor in telemedicine. Which are the limits? It is not specific, we said before, in defining the type of nocturnal disorder. It's also not sensitive in detecting a problem when oxygen is added to non-invasive ventilation, and this is frequent in COPD patients. And again, as I will show you after, it is not always sensitive in detecting hypoventilation. And this is the case. This is Mrs. Maria, 45 years. She's affected by myasthenia. She's ventilated during the night. And if I follow and monitor my patient with the oxygen profile, oxygen saturation profile, you can say this is a good profile, apart from some few oxygen desaturation. This is a good profile, but actually, in fact, I put her in monitoring of transcutaneous PCO2. As you can see, the mean PCO2 is higher than 55 millimeter of mercury. So actually, there is a residual hypoventilation. How can happen this? Actually, the main reason in patients in which lung is the ventilation perfusion matching is good, so in a healthy lung, it may happen because the patient, the starting oxygen saturation of the patient is high. So during the night, the hypoventilation is responsible for a variation of 20, 25, 30 millimeter of mercury of oxygen, and the same increasing in PCO2, but this movement of PO2 is responsible for a change only of 1-2% of oxygen saturation because the patient is starting from in the flat part of oxygen saturation curve. So a little really little variation of oxygen saturation for an important variation of alveolar PO2 and alveolar pCO2. So what about the nocturnal hypoventilation and the possibility to monitor it with a transcutaneous pCO2 monitoring? And why I kept it in the first level of monitoring and in bracket. This is Mr. Salvatore, 56 years old. He is an overlap, COPD and OHS. And actually, he started the non-invasive ventilation because chronic hypercapnic respiratory failure. And as you can see, arterial blood gases after the first consultation was not so bad. pCO2 was 46, PO2 good in ambient air. So good, really good arterial blood gases, good HAIM. And if we take a look at the oxygen saturation, actually you see it's really too good because it's 99% because we needed to ventilate this patient with adding oxygen because of ventilation perfusion mismatch due to COPD. So actually, if we stop after the oxygen saturation monitoring, we cannot detect that, as showed by transcutaneous, there is a persistence of a hypoventilation, very important in this case because you see here 70 millimeter of mercury, and the patient is for a long time with a pCO2 higher than 65 millimeter of mercury. So it's may be important because monitoring pCO2 may be an adding value to monitoring oxygen saturation. And this study showed this because in this study they compared only monitoring oxygen saturation and monitoring transcutaneous pCO2 in restrictive lung disorder. And whatever the cutoff of that we use to define nocturnal hypoxemia, that may be 30% of time spent with oxygen saturation lower than 19%, or more than 5 minutes spent with oxygen saturation lower than 80%, or even a cutoff of 95% of saturation, whatever the cutoff to define an acceptable nocturnal oxygen saturation, you can see you may have between 15 and 30% of patients who have nocturnal hypoventilation, persistent nocturnal hypoventilation. And so the question is, it's really important to detect this. In OHS patient, guidelines to start non-invasive ventilation changed recently. And actually the definition of HS is not more an hypercapnia detected at diurnal arterial blood gases, but as you can see here, there is a grading and the first three grades are patient with normocapnia at diurnal arterial blood gases, but with nocturnal hypercapnia. So in this patient may be important. But again, this study in which restricted neuromuscular patients were followed up to 5 years, actually, they surprisingly showed that despite normal arterial blood gases, so Largases were normalized by non-invasive ventilation, PCO2 was normal. 36% of them were admitted in ICU, and mortality rate at 5 years was 33%. And when they took a look at the oxygen monitoring and at the PCO2 monitoring, actually they found that either ICU admission and mortality rate was strictly related to persistent nocturnal hypoventilation and less related to persistent nocturnal oxygen desaturation. In particular, was correlated to these two definitions of nocturnal hypoventilation: PCO2 higher than 49 millimeter of mercury during more than 10% of the total recorded time, and peak of PCO2 higher than 55 millimeter of mercury. While the definition coming from AASM, that is PCO2 higher than 55 millimeter mercury for more than 10 minutes, did not correlate with these two outcomes. What about chronic COPD? Is it important to have as aim to correct also nocturnal hypoventilation? We did not. We did not, as the task force said, also if the strategy to completely correct diurnal PCO2 correlate with the outcome. So we don't know if a residual hypoventilation in this patient may correlate with the worsened outcome. So again, if we want to resume about capnography during NIV, we can say that the advantages are that it's very sensitive in detective hypoventilation, above all in healthy lung where oxygen profile may not detect hypoventilation. It is really very sensitive in detecting hypoventilation when oxygen is added to non-invasive ventilation, so the oxygen saturation profile is falsed by oxygen. Plug and play with ventilators is possible for many ventilators now, and for this reason it is possible also to monitor in telemedicine. What is the biggest limit and the reason why I put it in bracket, even if in the first level of monitoring, it's that it is expensive. It's expensive, the monitor, it's expensive, or the consumables. And another limit is that is not so sensitive in detecting periodic shock change in PCO2, either hyperventilation and hypoventilation. So hypocapnia and hypercapnia, if very short, they are not detected. This is one example. This is a typical profile, oxygen profile of on a SAIL patient. But as you can see in the transcutaneous profile, you cannot detect the rapid increase of CO2. What about the accuracy of this instrument? Actually, there are many studies published in the last years, and as this study that I showed conclude, the accuracy of transcutaneous measurements of PCO2 was acceptable for estimating PCO2 over a wide range of CO2 levels. So, taking into account all this aim and these goals as a first level of monitoring non-invasive ventilation, actually, if one of these goals are not reached, I need to go to a second level of monitoring. And a second level of monitoring means I have to take a look in details of recording data by using software, and above all, take a look at the possibility to look at two important problems, leaks and obstruction. Why I say only these two problems? Because, as was shown in this retrospective patient performed only in ALS patient, actually, they showed that 50% of these patients were not well tolerated. And the reason why it happened was, for the majority of cases, leaks. And for one third of cases, upper airway obstruction. It's true, this a retrospective study. It is a study only in ALS patients, but is the real life. Everyone is able to take a look every day at recording data, knows that leaks and obstruction are the most frequent problems and the most frequent reason for asynchrony. So how can I detect leaks? If you take a look at the details data, as you can see here, all the software give you the possibility to take a look at a trend of leaks. The only thing that is important for you is to know which software you are using and what kind of leaks they are showing you. Because in some software, you have the so-called total leaks, as in the Brea software. Total means the intentional leaks that are the leaks around the mask in the holes of the mask, plus non-intentional leaks, the leaks, the patient leaks, the leaks around the mask. In some other software, you have only the non-intentional leaks, so only the patient leaks. So you have to know what you are looking for. What happened to the flow when you have some leaks? Just starting from a very simple formula that actually is very important to understand what happened to the flow in a pressure target ventilation mode, that is the mode used during non-invasive ventilation. Actually, we know that if we have a lot of non-intentional leaks around the mask, the resistances in the circuit decrease. The resistances decrease, and if the pressure is constant, the flow have to increase. So actually, I expect an increase in the flow. And if I put a flow sensor between the mask and the circuit, this is what I can see. You can see here a normal flow curve, and after that, when the leaks start, you have an increase of the flow and the absence of the expiratory flow. Increase in inspiratory flow and absence of expiratory flow. But this is viewed with an external pneumotach close to the interface. What we see by the software is a treated data. You have to know that all the software treat data coming above from the flow. So again, you have to know how to use the information coming from the software. So for example, what the majority of the software make is to bring the flow close to the zero line every time the flow increase because the leaks. So as in this case, you can see here, there is an increase of non-intentional leaks, and you see a decrease of the flow that is different from what I told you before. Yes, because this flow is treated by the software. The Breas, in this case, offer you two different flow. A total flow that is similar to the flow detected by a sensor flow between the mask and the tube and the patient flow. And as you can see, when leaks are increasing, you have an increase of the flow as expected, but the flow treated show a decrease of it. So I invite you to follow the next webinar where how to read in details the flow signals will be explained better, and they will learn, teach you to detect better where there are leaks, even if the software is not able to detect it. But what is important, coming back to monitoring, is to know that leaks is one of the major determinants of oxygen desaturation. So non-intentional leaks is one of the major determinants of oxygen desaturation. Is one of the major determinants also of asynchrony. So it's really important to detect a problem, oxygen desaturation, and look for leaks, first of all. What about obstruction? If we consider again the formula flow and pressure, in presence of an upper airway obstruction, you have an increase, an abruptly increase of resistances. So if the pressure is constant, independent variable in pressure target ventilation, the flow have to decrease. And this is what happened and what we can see when we monitor the details data. So actually it is really very simple. If you have one night of this patient, as you can see here, you have your patient flow, total flow, you see very well how the flow abruptly decrease, suddenly decrease, and this is followed by an oxygen desaturation. So easy to know that in this case, there is an upper airway obstruction. So the question is, once obstruction is detected, is it enough to decide how to proceed? Not in always cases, because as you can see here, patient one and patient two has the same picture in flow, a decrease of flow in both cases. But if we put the bells in this patient, you have in the first case that the patient has a lot of movement during this flow reduction, and this movement increase, and there is also a tightening between abdomen and thorax. While in patient two, you have a decrease of the flow, the same decrease of flow, but this is not followed. There is not a movement of bells during this decrease of flow. That means that different underlying mechanisms are responsible for a reduction of flow. And in the first case, where there are movement and there are a tightening of abdomen and thorax, the main mechanism is represented by the classic oropharyngeal obstruction. And you see here very well as the ventilator push, even in controlled mode, but there is no flow. And you can see here the patient is tightening, the abdomen and thorax are tightening, and it is also in really not synchronized with the ventilator. What I have to do in this case is to try to improve the narrowing of the upper airway, so increase the EPAP value. While in this case where there is a reduction of flow and followed by an oxygen desaturation, and there is no movement in the bells, in this case, actually, by monitoring PCO2, I saw that this patient, just before this prolonged abolished of the drive had a very low PCO2. This is a mechanism mediated by a very important decrease of PCO2, so hypocapnia or abruptly decrease of PCO2 during the night, that is responsible for inhibition of the drive and a reflexed closure of the glottic. In this case, you do not have to increase EPAP, but on the contrary, you have to decrease the flow, so you inspiratory flow, so you have to decrease rise time, you have to decrease pressure support to be less aggressive. The question is, I don't have PELS, so can I make some diagnosis even without them? Yes, there are some possibilities. One is the probability, reason with the probability of incidence. For example, if you have this pattern in a COPD patient, difficult to think that is an abolishment of the drive. It's really more frequent to have an oropharyngeal obstruction, so increase EPAP. Another possibility is consider one mechanism and treat it and take a look the day after at your detailed course. Another possibility is take a deeper look, because sometime in the by only taking a look at the flow waveform, you can have more adding information. For example, here you have a decrease of flow, but between the supported breath, you have a movement that are a sort of ineffective effort. That means there is a drive. So in this case, I do not need the belts. Even with belts, I can confirm my hypothesis. There is a drive, I can increase the EPAP value. So what happened once I excluded leaks and I excluded obstruction, but I did not reach all the goals that I had in the first level of monitoring. Perhaps in this case, I need the best and I need polygraphy to exclude asynchrony. What is the impact of asynchronism in chronic non-invasive ventilation? We don't really know, because we know that asynchronism during invasive ventilation are significantly correlated with mortality, with a very poor outcome of invasively ventilated patient. On the other end, in a chronic patient, we know that patient ventilator asynchrony correlate with a bed comfort, and as we showed some years ago, correlate with a bed tolerance. And we know that tolerance of NIV may means a failure of NIV, but we don't have a really very strong evidence that this kind of problems during non-invasive ventilation may impact on the outcome. However, some years ago, we published this very interesting paper. Interesting because there are a lot of picture, and so I invite you to take a look at it. And actually, it is a sort of a flowchart to address you to have a good lecture of polygraphy under NIV, and actually to use a method to read the polygraphy and also to classify the events that you can detect during non-invasive ventilation. Once again, you have excluded obstruction and leaks. actually we considered to classify these events a polygraphy in which they are involved not only bells and oxygen's pulse oximeter, but also and pressure, a pressure transducer and a flow sensor. But again, now technologies helps us in all these way to monitor the patient. And for example, with Vivo 45 by Breas, you have the possibility to make a sort of a little polygraphy, because you can play, plug and play bells, pulse oximeter and transcutaneous PCO2, and you can record these for all the night, and the day after you can download your data from the ventilator, and as you can see here, you can have a pressure line, a flow, a total flow, and patient flow, and the pulse oximeter traces, the bells, and the transcutaneous, even if you have it. So really interesting to put these with only with the ventilator. Again, we don't have evidence, a lot of evidence about the role of asynchronism in the chronic patient ventilated at home, but there is an ongoing study in which four groups of chronic respiratory failure, COPD chronic respiratory failure, were randomized, and in one group patients were daily monitored by using software, so by using detailed waveform, above all flow, to change the setting. So we are waiting for knowing if change some and correct some asynchrony may impact on hospitalization or needing for mechanical ventilation or death. So I just leave you by invite you to the next webinar from Breas, the last Thursday of January, and the issue that will be treated will be non-invasive ventilation for obesity hypoventilation syndrome. And I thank you very much for your participation, and I'm waiting for some questions. Thank you very much.
Thank you very much, Annalisa, for a clear and well-structured presentation, guiding us from, let's call it, the basics to the full option package of monitoring. We have a few questions here in the chat, which came in during your presentation. The first one is, does AutoEPAP always eliminate upper airway obstruction? And if so, does this mean that we don't need to use abdominal and thoracic effort belts?
Thank you very much for the question. I think that it's really important to know how the AutoEPAP works in your ventilator. There are different ways to work. For example, there are some AutoEPAP who works by measuring, by using the forced oscillation method, the resistances of upper airway. This may be a limit. Why? Because we saw before that we can have an obstruction that may be the classic oropharyngeal obstruction that is an increasing of resistances, but we can have an obstruction that is a glottic reflection obstruction that is also an increasing of resistances. In both cases, this auto-EPAP will increase the EPAP value, but actually we said before, In the second case, I do not need to increase the EPAP. On the contrary, I need to change some other things in the inspiratory phase. So really important to know what is the method used by your software to increase the EPAP value.
Thank you. A second question which came in is, how much of the asynchronies shall we try to solve? Can some be accepted?
This is a good question, and this is the question actually with I left you with my presentation. We don't really know the really impact of all these, the asynchronism. We know that above all, ineffective effort may impact on the tolerance of non-invasive ventilation. I can assume that in a COPD patient where one of the aim of non-invasive ventilation is to reduce work of breathing, having ineffective effort is not a reduction of work of a breathing. So I assume that I have, for example, to detect it to reduce them. But in this moment, we don't have a study who really show the impact on the outcome. So what I normally do is I take a look every day or in consultation when the patient comes to some random night in the details if the asynchrony is present all the night, I try to make something. But again, I want to remember that in the majority of cases, even asynchronies are induced by leaks and obstruction.
Okay. A very practical question. How often do you use effort belts in your clinical practice?
Not for every patient. I think that the practice is useful to learn something, even by using only data coming from software. So I use less and less belts because I now we have cleared some pictures. I think that first of all, many information come from software. And only when I have a really doubt about my asynchrony and that I am not able to change to delay it, or if I make a lot of changes and I'm not really able to change the pattern, in this case I use the belt. But before all, every time I use only data coming from details, data coming from the software.
Yeah, and the next question is related to the software. Do you go through the whole study and score it manually, or do you look for PVA and make adjustments on what you see?
I do not make a scoring with what I say in the software. I do this only if I decide to put a polygraphy. But again, I take a look at the wall recording data and I make something if what I see is really frequent. So if I have only few ineffective effort, this is not a problem for me.
Just a personal or a question from me. How long does it take in general, in average, to look through such a night of data?
Now that we are really more expert because we do this from 4 or 5 years now, I can say some minutes 5 minutes for patients, more if we detect more events, because we discuss to try to decide what to change.
Okay, we have a question that came in based on an earlier answer you gave on the auto EPUB. You mentioned to watch out for algorithms using variable EPUB, as you said in as answer to a previous question. The question then, shall we also be careful when using variable IPAP?
Yes, it's the same. That means variable IPAP means that I have a volume target. That means that I need to know how the ventilator measure the volume target and which is the volume target monitored by the ventilator. That means if this volume, for example, contains also the leaks, non-intentional leaks, I could have a non-correct managing of IPAP on this variable. That means if the volume contains non-intentional leaks and I have important leaks, the volume increase and the ventilator could decrease the IPAP value. So again, it's really very important when you use an algorithm to understand how it works.
Yeah, two more questions. Again, very practical. We don't have transcutaneous CO2. Can it be replaced by morning ABG?
As I showed you before, no. But for example, in the new guidelines coming from OHS patient, where they introduce the concept of nocturnal hypoventilation, actually they suggest to take a look at bicarbonates at the arterial blood gases to suspect that there is a residual. In that case, there is an hypoventilation, and for non-invasive ventilation, a residual hypoventilation. But all doctors knows that bicarbonates may be affected by some drugs, by some disease, for example, kidney diseases. So it's really important to know what can be the limit of bicarbonates in the specific patient. Otherwise, not easy to detect. But perhaps this what I want to give as a message: the residual hypoventilation may be present and may be not detected by the other tools that we use, but it may regard only a little percentage of patients, first of all, and may be predicted, for example, from symptoms and clinical reporting of the patients.
Thank you very much. The last question which we have here on the list, we see patient apps being used in OSA a lot to help coach adherence and solve problems. Do you see a role for these apps in non-OSA patients with NIV?
It depends. It may be, in this case, I think that apart from the type of a patient, the age is very important. For example, my COPD patient, I think that they are not able to use their mobiles, so really difficult to use some apps. And Also the adherence also to the tools, to the instrument is very important. For example, very obese patients who are not adherent to nothing, perhaps difficult to use this. So again, perhaps we have to address it to the right patient, but it may be considered.
Okay, thank you very much. That was the last question, and we're closing this webinar for today. Once again, Professor Carlucci, I want to thank you for an excellent presentation and the strong guidance we got and the insights you gave us out of more than 5 years of scoring and practice, as you said. Thank you for that. I also want to thank all of you who attend today.